Welcome to ECGR 4101, 5101. This is lecture number 26. This will be a continuation of our discussion of operating systems, but as always, the application, or I should say the embedded application of the day, I'd like to go over right now. And that is, I got an email from my aunt, and she said, "I know you like to take things apart. I've got this picture frame that doesn't work anymore." And of course, it's not just a regular picture frame. It is a picture frame that is an embedded system, a digital photo frame. Now, this is going to be, when we go through this, this is going to be a pretty advanced embedded system. Not as advanced as an automobile, but it's going to have a lot more stuff in it than most of the embedded systems that I've actually looked at over the semester. So, in this case, we are looking at the Insignia, I think this is a Best Buy brand, digital photo frame. And I, rather than having you folks watch at me take this apart, I've already taken it apart. And it's nothing more than a back to this device and a front that has a frame and an LCD. So if we were to take off the skins of this and look at what is inside, a couple things I want to point out right away is that it has an interface. Remember, we said that embedded systems has not usually a full keyboard, but some other keys. Well, there you go. Here are your keys, which actually have a whole bunch of switches associated with it, and of course, an interface cable that will go to our board. It also has, in this case, a beautiful controller, and this is using an infrared device. So if we look at our entire device, we have this additional appendage right here, which is used for this infrared detector. And what's interesting about this is that it's connected to the motherboard, and we'll look at this in more detail. But with this motherboard, it's connected not only to data cables. Here we go, come on, focus. There we go. But it also has this additional wire here, which I suspect is associated with ground, because apparently it needs some pretty good grounding. And also this ground. So apparently it needs some pretty good grounding for that to work. And in fact, we'll see a little bit later that there are other devices here that add to the grounding. So if we scan out, this is simply the LCD, which is attached via this ribbon cable to our motherboard. And you notice that it almost looks like there might be some components on this ribbon cable, but in fact, if you look at it very carefully, it is not. But it is an integral part of the circuit because it has connecting wires on one side and the other side, including vias, which I've never seen on a cable before. It has vias that go through the cable. So I thought that was rather interesting. If we now look at the motherboard, we have several features of this which are rather interesting. Looking at the mechanical electrical features, each one of these pads right here are, believe it or not, glued, or I've not actually pulled this off, so let's pull this off. It is glued on, but the glue doesn't cover the entire pad. The glue actually covers only part of the pad. And if you notice carefully, silver, which means it's conductive, and when this silver pad touches the back of this LCD, it offers another level of grounding. Usually this is done to allow the device to pass the FCC Class 3 regulation, which says that you're not allowed to radiate too much radio energy. And we have, if you look at this, five of these, which are used for grounding and also to pad the LCD in case the thing moves around. Other than the usual, I believe these are transistors all over the place, we do have the, actually, is that a transistor or capacitor? I take that back, that's a capacitor. We do have three large chips as well as all the other passive devices that form this entire system. Also notice too that on the back it has a couple of places that you can plug in different memory devices. This is for a card of some sort, a memory card. But you also have a USB, and this would be that your entire board serves as the USB master. That's what this connection is for. But you can also connect this to a PC. That's what this USB port is for. So in that case, this port is used when this entire board is the slave of the connecting to a PC. The PC would be the master, this would be the slave. It also has a plug, and interesting enough, it has no battery. But it does have a lot of microprocessor, microcontroller goodies on it. And a couple of these I need to actually to pull out. And let me start with this one right here. I will have this in my class notes for the handwritten note. But I contacted this company, and AM Logic is a Chinese company that makes microprocessors for devices like this. A lot of multimedia going on. They gave me a whole list of capabilities of this, including the fact that this is a full-fledged microcontroller that has, I should say, a full-fledged microprocessor, because it doesn't have that much memory on it, that actually can control an LCD. It also has built onto it the capability of handling USB stacks, Bluetooth stacks, which I cannot find. I did not find a Bluetooth transmitter here, so I don't think it has it. But this chip will allow it to communicate with another Bluetooth device. It also has full capability to talk to USB as well as the memory cards that are attached. And oh, by the way, there's some additional pads here that you can put other memory card devices as well, which leads me to believe that this entire board might be a multi-purpose board. So it's used for this LCD screen, this application, but it could also be used for some other applications. So to go a little bit further, we also have a Toshiba. I almost hate to show you this because it shows you what you can find out there. By the way, this is a Toshiba confidential document, which actually is available on the web somewhere. So obviously if you're from Toshiba and you don't want anybody to see this, you should go up there and take it off. Look at this. It is a 16 gigabit double EEPROM. Basically, it is a flash device. And a double EEPROM as opposed to flash, because it's a little bit more or a little bit larger, and you won't be expected to write and rewrite this device so often. Note that that means that it's 2 gig by 8 bits, so it's a 2 gigabyte storage. So you use these 2 gigabytes to store all your pictures. How much is your typical photograph? Your typical photograph is only, let's say, 2 to 8 gigs. So it can hold a lot of different photographs there. I will not put this out there on the web, so I will just mention it. But this is a Toshiba double EEPROM. The other device, by the way, here is the Toshiba part right here. And then the other device on here is a WinBond 1 meg by 4 16-bit SD RAM. And so if I were looking at the, and again, I mentioned what the largest parts of this are for the system. Again, this is our Insignia digital photo frame. And to be honest with you, I don't know how old this is. If I were to guess, I'd say this is about 2 years old at least, which means that this was probably designed 3 to 3.5 years ago. Again, I said the primary devices you have here is the AM Logic AML6223DF processor. You have the WinBon 1 meg by 4 way by 16 bit SD RAM. So there's, if you remember our computer architecture, there's our RAM memory. What is this? 1 meg times 4, 4 meg times 16, 8 megabytes, right? 8 megabytes of SD RAM. Is that a lot? Well, most machines right now are running with a lot more than 8 megabytes. Remember, we're looking at some of the newer PCs that are out nowadays that are looking at gigs of memory. But again, this is not used so much for running Windows and all this other stuff like that. It's just for the operating system and for being able to run this device once it is powered up and boots up. The other is a Toshiba E2 PROM. And again, the capabilities of this are 16 gigabit or equals to 8 gigabytes. So as a PC, this doesn't have that many capabilities or this much memory available to run like your typical laptop. But as a small, inexpensive photo frame, it's got a lot of features. This is the type of device that people who are in the embedded world will need to look at. They're looking at these 32-bit processors. They're looking at lots of memory, but not quite as much as a laptop. All right, so what I'd like to do is continue on with lecture 26, which is the operating system. And to that, there are some notes that are available for this. So let's start. Now, when you have an operating system and you will have one or many programs running, there's the capability for starting a specific task. We've talked about tasks already. Continuing on with that task until some point where it needs a resource, that task then gets put on hold and you start or continue a new task. Remember, there's always one task that's running. There are several others that are waiting to run. Well, in that case, you never know. Two may be using the same data, and there might be some sort of coherency problem between those two different tasks running, or different processes, or different threads, whatever you nomenclature you use for your operating system. So when there are these multiple threads processes running, you have to make sure that you keep track of every time they change. So there are some that will change all the time that you need to make sure that they are identified as important and must be updated atomically. In other words, when you use it, when you read it, your intention is to write it back immediately. That's called a volatile variable. We'll look at that a little bit later. There are some that are just read, and you don't really care to have it updated frequently. So we need to ensure that our operating system will know the difference between the two, and that any program that runs will actually use it correctly. So for that, we have different mechanisms. We have things called, we have devices called monitors. But then we have to take a look at the bugs that will be created when we look at this process coordination and data sharing. So let's get into it. Volatile data is the concept where a specific piece of memory or a specific variable in memory is going to change. In other words, when you're using it, Maybe it's used by other processes as well, and they change it as well. So it has to be updated frequently, and everybody needs to make sure they have the most recent version. So to save time when you're running, often a program or a task will not reload a variable from memory every time it's used. Remember, we're running from our variables are stored in memory, but you can bring that into registers and use them from the registers. So what you're really maintaining is the process for when you move it from memory into a register, use it, and then write it back from the register into memory. So when you're trying to optimize, you don't want to have to call from memory every single time you use it if you're just reading it. However, if you're going to read it, change it, move it back, you will want to write it back. Or maybe it turns out that this is such an important piece of memory, that this variable is so important that somebody else is changing it too, so you've got to grab it every time you work with it. So we'll look at that. How do you ensure that anything you use is the most recent version of it? Well, as we mentioned before, when you run an interrupt service routine, there will be situations where the interrupt will run and it may use a variable that has already that is currently being used by another process or thread that was the active one. So that's another case too where you have to watch out for the coherency of that data. So we have something called a volatile directive. A volatile doesn't mean that this variable is going to explode in your face. A volatile keyword is used to say that this is an atomic action. In other words, if I ever use this variable, you will fetch it, use it, and put it back before anybody can interrupt you to start another task, to service an interrupt service routine. And that's valuable to know because then you're assured that that variable is the most recent one. And one thing, these are different ways that you can define, for example, an integer or something else like that. Now, what you have to worry about is that if that's an atomic operation, usually it's going to be subsumed in several assembly language instructions. It may occur in just one single C instruction, but it is going to be spread across several different assembly language instructions, which then translate into several different machine language, which means that you have to make sure that an interrupt doesn't occur in the middle of two of those instructions. We'll see an example in a minute. Now, let's go a little bit higher than that. Is very often the way you want to share information or you want to use information is that there is a global storage area and several different threads actually use that same data. And you want to coordinate it such that only one of these processes or threads want to work with it or can work with it at one time. This goes to a little bit higher level. In other words, you could make a volatile, which will then stop interrupts, allow you to use the variable, and then release it. Or you can go to another higher level of abstraction, whereas a whole bunch of instructions are done at one time, and because of the nature of operating systems where you have multiple processes running at one time, you can actually stop another processor from using it until you indicate, I'm done. And we're going to look at that. By the way, when we do this cooperation, we can share memory or we can pass messages between two different threads or processes. And these are common things that are done that started out from the parallel processing area, but has been extended to real-time operating systems now as well. So, when do you want to use shared memory? Well, for most of your embedded systems, they're a single smaller system that maybe has multiple functionalities. So in that case, you really want to have shared memory, but you have to protect it so that this shared memory is not, you want to protect it so that no other process is able to change somebody, another process's shared memory, somebody's memory, unless they allow you to do that. Well, in the case of most high-end systems, something like Unix, a process is not able to change the memory directly. It actually has to ask the operating system to do that. And so that's going to be some of the examples we see later when we start sharing data and allowing different processes to access one certain part of memory. We actually say, operating system, I want that piece of memory and that variable. Bring it to me when I'm done. I'll let you know when I'm done. So we have in our low-end systems, as we said, access to global variables. Along that same lines, though, when we have Unix and high-end systems, we have something called virtual memory. For, as I said, everybody gets their own little piece of memory. And the operating system knows that one process can access memory space A, one can access memory space B. Message passing, as we've mentioned before, is useful when the communications cost is high. In other words, when you have different processors in different places. A good example for this would be instant automobile. There is no way that a processor in the front of the vehicle is going to be able to share memory in the same memory space with a processor at the back of the vehicle. It's just too far away to communicate to a single piece of memory. So the way to do that is you pass a message from one place to the other saying, I need that data, and then you get it. Again, we're now looking at situations where the operating system is going to, as much as possible, is going to manage all of our messages. Oh, by the way, there's a process, or there's something called a mailbox, which is nothing more than a queue with only one entry. Let's look at this. This is a nice, good example, and you never know when something like this will show up on a test. Hint, hint, hint. If we're going to look at these different variables, we have something which is identifying the temp variable, all right? And then we have the one variable, TC, high, and then we have TC. So let's take a look at this. We have, the problem we have right now is we have a 32-bit number, really long, right? Our processor works with 16 bits. The big problem you have is that you have to split our data, which we're calling temp, right, into 16-bit pieces when you work on it at one time. And this is one of the problems when we're talking about shared data. We have two different things going on. We have up there, you notice the interrupt. So there is an interrupt up there that is running, and all it does is it looks at TC, time count, and it increments it by one. And so it's obvious that it would go from FFFF, you add one to it, it goes 0000. So the thing is, when you add one to this, you also want to increment the second part of this, the TC high, time count high. So you would expect that once this goes from FFFF, you add one onto it, you would expect this to add up to 0123 because you've incremented it, 0124. Since you've incremented this, you would expect this to increment as well. And that's how you want it to work. And in fact, that interrupt works correctly. The problem comes down to when you are using it. So if we're trying to get the number of timer ticks, remember we're only able to get 16 bits at a time. So we want to make sure to grab both this one and this one at the same time, right? So here our number is really 0123 FFFF. The next time the timer tick goes through, 0124 0000. That's what we want, so that when we pull it into a 32-bit number, it should be correctly 1234 0000. The problem, and this is how I'm going to step through, is what happens. I would think that this entire process right here would be atomic. In other words, during this time, I would not want to be interrupted. So here's how we're going to build the problem up if we're interrupted, or this is the problem we'll see if it's interrupted. So let's go step by step. Step number one, you have this line being executed. So you're copying over TCH high or TCHI over to 10. And of course, it's going to put it in the lower byte of this long word, right? So then the next thing you want to do is you want to shift it up 16 bits. So that's where we are in step number two. So now, obviously, we're taking this, we're moving it here, then we're shifting it up 16 bits, and obviously the next thing is to pull this over and put it at the end there. But the problem that happens is that in step number three, we get interrupted. And in the interrupt, at that point in time, after this is executed, that would be a very critical thing to do, but no, we go to the interrupt next, which means that, hey, look at this. This is where we've added, we've incremented here, and because that went to zero, this is incremented. Well, the goal is we really would want over here temp to be finally either 123FFFF or 124000. Oops, there should be another zero there. Sorry about that. So once step number three is executed and we've done the increment, then we get back to here and we're taking TC, which has been changed, and we're putting and adding it into temp, which means that this number here, which should be 124000, is not correct. And this is the whole problem with the shared data, or this is the shared data problem. This is what you will see when you're doing operating systems and you're sharing information between different processes. Now, what we're going to look at in the next few slides is how we fix this. Let's talk about some definitions. Number one, a critical section is what we call non-reentrant. In other words, it is specific code that is occupied by one process or should only be occupied by one process at one time. Typically, this is something like an interrupt, but it could be something else like a synchronization mechanism like we saw right in the example code, right? So an reentrant code can have multiple simultaneous interleaved or nested invocations that will not interfere with each other. And then a race condition is a bad behavior, or I should say situation, due to unexpected critical dependencies based on timing. So as you've seen in your digital logic courses before, race conditions are such that when things start moving around depending on timing. And if we look at the previous example, what happens if we had been interrupted here? So in this case, TC high was interrupted, and we went up there, we did the interrupt service routine, and then we came back down. Would we have gotten the same results? Yes, would have been the same results. However, what happens if we were interrupted right here? In other words, instead of this going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, what if it were 1, 2, 3, then 4, then 5? The answer is, we would get the correct result this time. So in this case, the race condition, this is an example of a race condition that really is primarily dependent on relative timing and seemingly random timing associated with it. This is the hardest bugs to ever find because it's random and you have to go through and track. And in fact, since it's associated with relative timing, it's something that is very difficult to find if you are running a debugger and stepping through. Because in this case, you're worrying about specific interrupts occurring based on real time as opposed to your single step through a bit of code. Now, if you were to look at a little bit more detail, this is an example of why we're having these problems, because a single line of C code is being expanded into several lines of assembly. So up there, here you go. We have a situation where a simple increment is that you're taking and you're adding a single value to a variable and then returning. As opposed to in this situation, let's see, we have a long integer, so that means that in this case, it is being stored as 16 bits, and you're going to ADCF, which stands for, I believe that would be add on carry flag, which means that if you are incrementing a variable that goes from FFFF, ooh, I could even draw this on the screen. Let's do that. Let's see if I could actually draw it on the screen. We cannot. So again, if we're looking at the situation where you're going from FFFF and you're adding 1 to it, that is obviously equal to, and this is of course hex, this is obviously equal to 0 hex 1 F 0 0 0 0, correct? Well, in the case, this is stored into a register, which then will be put into memory. This is actually put into the carry flag. And that assembly language instruction that I pointed to says nothing more than, okay, if we have the carry flag here, then what you want to do is you want to increment one as well for this. So again, this is add whatever is in CT plus 2, add the carry flag to it. Now, take a look at this down here. We have a void. If CT is equal to, oh, look at that, 10000. So again, question is, what is F2 starts running after F1's add W? In other words, we are running this. This will result in a possible situation adjusting the carry flag, either erasing it or putting something in it. And this is another situation of a race condition due to a non-atomic operation. So, we've looked at our previous queue access for the serial communications, right? We had the situation where, again, right up here, the queue, you're incrementing the size. That operation actually takes these four assembly language instructions, even though this is a single line of C code. So what are you doing? Well, you're taking the size of this and you're putting it into two registers, then you're adding 1 to it. As opposed to in this situation, you're taking the size as well, then you're subtracting 1 from it. Look at these 4 different instructions. I know it doesn't look very efficient, but by the way, this is because the compiler vendor wants you to buy the licensed and optimized version, which would probably wipe this down to 1 instruction. But here's the one thing that it also doesn't include too, is this is coming from memory. You're not even putting it back into memory. So, let's go back to our previous example. That being, what if we have a whole bunch of, or we have this process right here. Remember, this is the one that was interrupted during its execution. So what if we wanted to make sure that nobody would ever interrupt it? And in this case, we want to make sure that the entire process there completed, and then once it's completed, we'll let interrupts occur. Well, look at this situation here. The main critical part here is when you read the TC high, shift it, and then read the TC, right? And then add it to temp. Well, we want to ensure that is temp is correct. We want to ensure temp is accurate. Now, the one thing to keep in mind too is if somewhere during this, if TC would increment, that's fine. At least it's only a little bit old, but it's not incorrect. In other words, we want to make sure that this is as accurate as possible and at least correct within 1. Right? So in this case, yeah, that'll do it. We disable interrupts. That means no interrupts can occur. And then we do our critical part, and then we enable interrupts. So, can you see anything wrong with that? Well, the big one is, what if interrupts were already disabled? So, interrupts were disabled, you got to this point, you did your critical stuff, and then you enable them. But you didn't want them enabled right here, because there's still something else that disabled it earlier. Oh. Well, that might not be good, right? So maybe we need to know if this was disabled before, right? So, oh, and the other problem is when you disable interrupts, it increases the amount of time that the interrupt service routine can address something, which actually may be bad too. That's why it's usually bad to disable interrupts. And usually the best process for working with interrupts is to address something quickly, save it on a queue, and allow another program like this to work with whatever data was received from the interrupt. So, now we said, okay, let's check to see if interrupts were already enabled or if they were disabled. And so here are some tricky little pieces of code. I love stuff like this on tests. Hint, hint, hint. So the tricky little piece of code says that we're going to run this assembly language instruction, which is going to actually store into this variable called x. Into this variable called x, we're going to save whatever we look at or whatever we read from the flags. So give me the status of the flags. In particular, I'm going to mask out 1 single bit, which tells me if I have interrupts enabled. And oh, by the way, we define what does it mean by enabling interrupts and disabling interrupts? Yeah, that means that you're going to set or clear the interrupt bit in the flag. So in this case, we're going to get what the status is. And oh, by the way, because we are using a pound define, this x is now identified to be the variable iFlag. All right? So we get what the status is, which will give us just a 0 or 1. And based on if we are enabled or disabled, or if the bit is set or not set, if it is already, in this case, if it is already set, well, look at this, we just disable it anyhow. And if it was, if interrupts were already disabled, then this won't go through. But if interrupts were enabled at this point, when it read what the flag value was, if interrupts were enabled, then it will re-enable them. So that's our solution. What do you think? Well, what did it cost you? It costs one extra instruction for storing this. Look, it's only a single, well, it's an assembly language instruction, and then a mask right here. So it looks like two instructions, right? Or an and, I should say. And of course, then the enable and disable. Oh, and this other one down here for a comparison. So it looks like three additional instructions. Here's another option that doesn't even work with interrupts at all. And here's the neat thing, is that it actually has, if this code is running slow enough, it actually has a repeated while loop that you may never exit. But we'll see why. So in this case, we have at the top, you are temporarily storing TC high, then you're shifting it over, then you're grabbing TC. Similar to the previous code that we had in our original instruction, right? So we're grabbing TC high, we're shifting it over, then we're adding TC. Then we're kind of voting. In other words, then let's do it again. And if the two are the same, then we return. And is that a good thing to do? Well, it depends on how fast the code runs and how fast the interrupts occur. Remember, the problem is that you have interrupts that are occurring every single n times, right? And they're incrementing TC. So anytime TC changes, you're going to do this again. But at the very least, it will catch the problem where in the middle of this point right here, unfortunately, also up there if it happens. So in other words, it could stay here at least two times if the error occurred up there. But each time you go through, what you do is you say, okay, the last one I recorded, I'm going to save. So in other words, you have to have an instance where two times you did the operation, it was the same number. Is that good? Well, you're doing additional work. Hopefully, the compiler may not optimize out the code. So, in another situation, if TC is changing so frequently that cannot happen, here's another option. And again, you're using the disabling and enabling interrupts, again, using this situation. Or this flag when you first work at the beginning. When you go into the code, you check to see if interrupts are enabled. Then you do the operation. We see this again, remember the temp, then you return it. So in other words, what you're doing is, every time you go through, you'll repeat again and again. Remember, if IRTCIC, what is IRTCIC? Well, that's looking at the interrupt, right? So again, we kind of use some of the concepts from the previous one and this one, or the previous two situations that we saw. The other final one is to use what's called a lock. And that is you rely on the operating system, or you start building up the concepts in the operating system of being able to lock and unlock a specific variable. So in this case, the specific variable is called TC and TC high and temp. Those are the two things that are actually TC and TC high. Those are two variables that are going to be your resource to protect. And then the operating system will say, I want to go out and grab that. And so it will say, is the variable locked? And then if it is not locked, then you will go out and lock it. So that's why you set the lock var equal to 1, which means that now you have control of whatever your resource is, TC high, TC. Once you're done using it, then you unlock it, and then you're done. So notice up there, the simple steps are 0, or the value 0 is the device is locked. I'm sorry. When you have 0, when lock is equal to 0, that means the resource is available. So here you go. You say, is it 0? It's available. I immediately lock it, and then I enable interrupts. I use whatever my resource is, so nobody else can check and do anything else. And then when I'm done, I disable interrupts. I should say, I enable interrupts, which means, okay, let me start all over again. Number one, you disable interrupts. What disabling interrupts does right now is it protects this variable from anybody changing it. Because you've disabled interrupts altogether. You check the variable. If the variable is 0, that means your resource right here is available. You then lock it to say that I only have access to this variable or whatever this resource is. Then you can enable interrupts again, and any other process or thread can interrupt to its heart content, but it cannot touch that resource that you need. In one example we showed earlier, TC and TC high. So what we're going to have is a using of the access or access the resources. Then you will disable the interrupts to work again with this variable that you're using to lock, I should say. And then you enable interrupts again and everything goes on its way. By the way, if you go out there and you find that somebody already is using this resource, in other words, if lock var is equal to 1, then you try again later. Try again later means you have some sort of random delay and then you try again. This is, gets into a very higher level of effort in the operating system. Now, when we're talking about these read modify instructions, there are some assembly language instructions like bit test and set that can be done on one specific instruction. By the way, that was for the Motorola 68C. There's a similar one for the Renesas processor that we're using this semester. I'm going to go beyond that one. Now, when we're getting into the higher operating system type of environment, we have what's called a spin lock. And that's simply you use that test and set variable to say, while it is false, then you can lock and unlock based on whatever that variable is. So in this case, you're going to test and set. You can call these. And as soon as you have access to it, then you can go on to the next instruction in your thread or in your process. Notice that when you're all done, all you do is you release the lock. And this is an atomic operation. This changing whatever your lock is, it's just simply a single instruction to say, do I want to test this? All right, I'm going to test it. If I have access, that means, again, we have a variable up there called lock, which is locking another variable. So in other words, this other variable is going to be the guarded resource that you have. By the way, I said that variable over there, that could be several variables. It could be an entire array. It could be a disk drive. It could be an entire resource. So a simple spin lock is a way for you to lock a variable, then go and use it, and then unlock it. And this is something common in operating systems. Now, again, slow and wasteful, because if you don't have access to it, then you just try again and again and again until it's available. Which means that you can have a process that is locked out because somebody else has access to it. And by the way, we can also disable the scheduler, meaning that only one thing happens at a time. That's a bad thing. Or we could use what's called a semaphore. And a semaphore, let's see if I want to get into this. I'm running out of time really quickly. I'll address this really quickly. A semaphore is another mechanism very similar to a lock, which only allows one single process to use it at a time. And the nice behavior of this is that you ask for permission to go into a critical section of code, you get into it, and when you're done, you release it. And you only are able to do that if you have access to all of the resources. These all have different names: take wait pen, release signal post, and it could be a counting one in which it actually shares information about queuing this up, or it could just be single binary. As an example here, if you have the resource called counter, which is very valuable, you can have a semaphore associated with that counter. Again, very similar to the test and set. You take it, but you wait there until you can get the resource called counter. Once you have it, then you use that resource with assurance that nobody else is changing it, and then you release it. And by the way, this is a situation where you have two different functions that could use it. Notice that they both have to say take the counter and then release it when they're all done. So if we look at the general concepts of sharing data, you can do everything from disable task switches, disable interrupts, use a lock, disable the scheduler, or to use a semaphore. Notice that we say a OS provided semaphore. Typically a purchased real-time operating system, or for that matter something like real-time Linux or any other real-time operating system, will have these available, and you'll be given instructions on how to use those. I'm getting really short to the amount of time to finish up, so let me see if I have a couple of things. I do want to address something that we discussed earlier, and in that case, what we have is a concept of deadlock. So in this case, we have a need for a resource, two different resources, associated with X and Y. And again, we'll be using one of our semaphores where we say, okay, I need to use whatever the resource X is and whatever the resource Y is. All right, remember, we're looking at counting semaphores, something like that. Well, notice process A and process B. In the case of process A, it's not going to do anything until it has both X and Y available. So it'll wait for X, and as soon as it gets X, it'll wait for Y. And as soon as it gets both X and Y, then it'll use it and then release it. Now, if another process says, I'm going to use X and Y as well, but I'm going to ask for Y first, then X. Well, here's the problem that you might encounter. If you have a situation where these two run at about the same time, and then A is locks X, and then suddenly, because of an interrupt or some other context switch, B starts to run, and then it successfully locks Y, but then it gets to X, and it can't get it because A already has it, and so it just sits there. And the problem associated with that is that now that A and B have locked a resource, neither of them will give it up based on the way this this mechanism is created. And we have what's called deadlock. This is similar to the the starving philosopher's problem, which I often do in class, but didn't have time to do that today. So the situation of deadlock is where two or more processes are unable to proceed because the processes are waiting for one or the other to do something. And there are other situations like live lock and live lock where you have a similar type of situation. So the prevention is you have to make sure that all processes, typically the best way is they must request all resources at the same time and in the same order. Or if a process requests a resource which is unavailable, then it releases all the resources that it had currently grabbed. It waits for a certain amount of time and then it tries it again. And that will prevent deadlock, but that will also cause a loss of work. Another is to avoid by predicting it, or another one is detection. In other words, additional operating system software that will look for detection and recovery if it detects that something is going on. All right? So, I did not get to the concept of scheduling, but as we've seen before, there are other aspects of an operating system that you can look at, which I will leave to the notes for you to review. That being, remember, ready, waiting, running, terminated, and there are different ways to schedule those that are in the ready queue. There are different ways to schedule those here in the ready queue to be moved to running, and then you can do that by one of the different scheduling algorithms. First come, first serve, round robin, shortest job first. These are detailed later in our notes, and I would recommend you take a look at those in great detail. This is it for the embedded systems lecture. This is the last one. Thank you very much.